Check it out now, y'all.
nanoHUB-U, online instruction.
Hi, I am Edmund Garcia. Welcome back. This is lecture 4 of the second week on the material science of rechargeable batteries. Today I'm going to talk about thermal effects on the equilibrium potential of a battery material. Just to remind you what we have been discussing this week, we have learned that at equilibrium, two phases, either two phases within the same electrode or two phases that you want to exchange a charge between them, have the same temperature at equilibrium, that a voltage develops between them because as they exchange mass, there could be a chemical potential difference that will induce instead a voltage difference. Equivalently, that is, you can say that the electrochemical potential is uniform across the system, leading with that to a material potential in volts, given in terms of a chemical potential difference between the two phases at equilibrium, modulated by the valence of the ion and the Faraday's constant. Now, we discussed last class how the equilibrium between two phases impacts on the shape of that potential as a function of equilibrium for fixed temperature. Now, what we're going to do today is talk about how temperature will disrupt that voltage temperature dependence. And so for that, in order to describe that, we need to go back to fundamentals, okay? And if we look back at our notes on classic thermodynamics, we find that the Gibbs free energy of mixing, or the Gibbs free energy of the system, or if you prefer the chemical potential difference between both phases, can be written in terms of this Legendre transform, where delta G is the Gibbs free energy of mixing, delta H is the enthalpy of the transformation, and T is the absolute temperature, and delta S is the entropy of the system, the entropy difference. Okay, so we can relate how that delta J relates to the enthalpy by making this very simple change of variables. Basically, we can divide delta G by T, okay, which basically cancels that T. If we assume that for the purposes of this transformation, delta H is not dependent on temperature, which is true for very small changes in temperature, then basically that derivative gives me effectively delta H. And we can do the same for the entropy, basically just simply take the derivative of the Gibbs free energy with respect to temperature. This is a very classic thing to do in a standard thermodynamics book. And that will basically give me the entropy of the system. Okay. If for a Legendre transform, the entropy is always referred to as being positive, okay, making this derivative having a negative value. And delta H, if you are spending energy to overcome the transformation, that will make that delta H positive. Okay, now from previous lectures, we have concluded that the voltage really corresponds to that Gibbs free energy of the transformation divided by ZF. So if we agree with that, then we can readily identify by dividing this whole expression by CF, okay, that the temperature dependence of the voltage with respect to the derivative of the voltage with respect to temperature really corresponds to the entropic term divided by ZF. Okay, and if delta S is positive, then what this term is telling us is that if the temperature increases on a battery, the voltage is going to drop. Okay, the equilibrium potential is going to drop. That is, of course, assuming that we're not extracting any charge out of it at a very fast rate. Basically, everything occurs very, very slowly. Okay, we also know that because the enthalpy is related to the voltage in this other way, okay, we can also say that we could use our measurement of voltage as a function of temperature to measure essentially the enthalpy of the system, as you can see here. I mean, and it's very straightforward to do that. Basically, just go and substitute this number over there, go and substitute this number over here, and then I just basically solve for delta H, and I will find that by simply measuring the voltage and the voltage dependence with temperature, I will have a measure effectively of the enthalpy, and basically having a graphical, very simple way to measure the enthalpy of an electrochemical system. Okay. Now, another number that comes out of this is the curvature of the voltage as a function of temperature, which basically we can find very easily by simply taking the derivative of this expression that we already have with respect to temperature. That means, because ZF is a constant that comes out of the system, if I take the derivative of the entropy with respect to temperature, that basically gives me the heat capacity divided by T, which the heat capacity is, for a stable system, is known to be positive. So that means that not only the slope of the voltage with temperature is negative, but as it comes down, it'll come down with a negative curvature. Basically, it will not only come down, but it will also bend down downwards as the temperature increases. What does that mean graphically? It means that if I have my voltage as a function of temperature, okay, then my voltage, as I increase my temperature, if what I said on the previous slide is true, it will come down, but it'll come down with a negative curvature, and we could use that that description to effectively measure what the local entropy of the system is, okay, by simply measuring the slope, okay, and we can also measure the heat capacity of the system by measuring what the local curvature of the system is and relate it directly to the expression that you saw on the previous slide, giving us with that a very nice graphical representation when we make this experiment, as not only as to what the properties of that voltage is, but other intrinsic properties such as entropy and heat capacity that can be used to specify the transport and additional stability contributions from the system. Okay? Now, if you have a phase transition in the system, that would mean that you not only have the alpha phase, but when you have a two-phase system, you may have also the beta phase, okay, which may or may not have a different, a higher voltage, but when you go from a one-phase system, say from alpha, you transition to beta, what will happen is that at one point they will share the same slope, and whatever you see at this continuity of the voltage in this voltage versus temperature plot, keeping the curvature and the slope negative, what you will see is that that discontinuity will signal the existence of a phase transition as a function of temperature. Forget about, in this case, the composition contribution. Simply by heating up your battery for fixed composition, okay, the voltage will be dropping until you reach a phase transition, at which point the slope will change, and maybe even the curvature will change, suggesting that there was a change on the entropy of the system and a change on the heat capacity. Okay, here's a couple of examples just to show you that type of description. And what you see here is for the, well, we did just, we're just discussing that on the previous lecture. And here we have the lithium antimony bismuth system. You have the voltage as a function of temperature. Okay, and what you have here is how the antimony, lithium two antimony system, you can see how the voltage is decreasing as the temperature increases, suggesting very clearly how the entropic contribution is dominating the system. For the Li2Sb system, you can see the same type of response, except that now you have a much more negative slope, suggesting that the entropic contribution is greater. And what I find here very interesting is here you have the bismuth, you can see the S means solid here, LIBI system, and how it undergoes this discontinuity on the slope. Why? Because now you have the liquid bismuth in at equilibrium with the LIBI system, and how you go from a flat voltage, basically very poor temperature dependence, but the moment it undergoes a phase transition, then the temperature dependence becomes very linear. Okay, for the LIBI an Li3B system, you can see that the temperature dependence is always negative, suggesting that really in general, and unless we can find a clinical system, the slope becomes always negative or zero, okay, and or very close to zero as you see here, and the heat capacity of the system must be very low so that the curvature, we cannot even tell it apart. It basically becomes very, very flat, almost non-existent. It is there, but it will be, it's hard to tell it apart from this data. Okay. Now, what we will do in the next lecture, I will be summarizing what we have learned this week and so that you can get a big picture sense of what we have learned this particular week. Thank you.